In this diagram, you can see that electron gun is producing electron beam. Hello friends, today I'm going to discuss about principal and the basic concepts of SEM and TEM under electron microscopy. So what is SEM? SEM means scanning electron microscopy and TEM means transmission electron microscopy. As its name suggests, electron microscopy means electron will be used as a radiation source in this technique. Now here question arises, why we are using electron microscopy? So whenever greatest resolution is required, in that case we have to use electron microscopy. If we are talking about either SEM or TEM, then both will give highest level of resolution. So whenever highest resolution is required, in that case we have to use either TEM or we can use SEM. If we are talking about TEM, then depth resolution range will be 1 to 10 nanometer, which is very high resolution. If we are talking about SEM, then depth resolution will be 10 to 100 nanometer. And if we are talking about lateral resolution of TEM, then it will be 0.1 to 1 nanometer, or you can say that 100 picometer to 1 nanometer. And if we are talking about SEM, then it will be 1 to 10 nanometer. Now coming to the magnification of SEM and TEM. So magnification will also be very high in the case of SEM and TEM. If we are talking about SEM, then magnification will be 50 to 5 lakh x. And if we are talking about TEM, then it will be 2000 to 1 million x, which is very high magnification. So these are the magnification value of SEM and TEM. If we are talking about SEM, then it will be 10 to 5 lakh times, which is represented by 10 to 5 lakh x. If we are talking about TEM, then it is very high. That is starting from 2000 and it will go up to 10 lakh x, that is 1 million. That is very high. And if we are talking about electron microscopy, then this cannot be performed for living cell or any living material. So this electron microscopy cannot be done for living cell or any living material, and the images of electron microscopy can show the ultra structure of the cells, means what are the structures or ultra structures present in the cell that can be visible by using SEM or TEM or any specimen. Now I am going to draw a block diagram to understand the principle of SEM and TEM, and it will be like this. So this is the diagrammatic representation to understand the principle of same and term, which is also visible here. So here we have taken a specimen or sample, and the electron beam will act as a radiation source. So when this electron beam will strike the sample, so there is four possibilities. First possibility is that it will produce secondary electrons. Second possibility is that it will produce backscattered electrons. Third possibility is that it will emit X-rays. And the fourth possibility is that it will transmit the electrons. Now coming to the first possibility, that is production of secondary electrons. So here when this electron beam will strike the specimen or sample, then electrons present in the sample will be knocked out by this electron beam, and those electrons will be converted in the form of secondary electrons. So basically these secondary electrons are coming from the inner shell of this sample or specimen. For better understanding of production of these secondary electrons, you have to watch my previous videos on production of X-ray. Link of those videos are given in the description as well as in the I button. Now coming to the second type of electrons, those are backscattered electrons. So when this electron beam will strike the specimen, then some of the electrons will be reflected back by the sample, and those electrons are known as backscattered electrons. Now coming to the third one, that is emitted X-rays. So to understand the emission of X-ray, you have to watch my previous videos on production of X-ray. So when this electron beam will strike the specimen or sample, then some of these electron beams will be absorbed, and that will be converted in the form of photons, and that photons will be emitted in the form of X-rays. Now coming to the fourth one, those are transmitted electrons. So when this electron beam will strike the sample or will hit the sample, then some of the electrons will be directly transmitted. Now coming to the principle of SEM, that is scanning electron microscopy. So in SEM, primarily it will determine the secondary electrons by using suitable detectors, and along with these secondary electrons, it will also determine backscattered electrons as well as emitted X-rays, and all these data will be combined by SEM, and it will give the same image. Now coming to the principle of TEM, that is transmission electron microscopy. So in TEM, we will determine these transmitted electrons, and by using these transmitted electron, we will get the TEM image. So coming to the details about SEM. So what is SEM or scanning electron microscopy? Electrons which are reflected back from the specimen in the form of secondary electrons, backscattered electrons, or emitted X-rays in the form of photons are collected, and the surface of the specimen is imaged in 3D and black and white. So in SEM, all these three electrons will be collected, and it will be detected, and by using those data, it will be converted in the form of image, and that image will be 3D, and it will be present in the form of black and white. Now coming to the details of TEM or transmission electron microscopy. So in TEM, electrons those are passed through the sample or specimen. These are the electrons which are passed through the sample, and these are known as transmitted electrons. are imaged and gives the idea about the internal structure of the sample. So these electrons will be detected by using suitable detector. Generally CCD or charged coupled detector is used in them, and this will give the internal structure of the sample. So in TEM, these transmitted electrons will strike onto a fluorescent screen or fluorescent plate, and in that fluorescent screen or plate it will be converted in the form of image. So electrons transmitted through this sample will strike into the fluorescent screen, which will be present here, and it will be converted into image which is 2D and black and white. If we are talking about same, then it will form 3D image, but in TEM it will form 2D, but both image will be black and white. Now coming to the radiation source used in electron microscopy. So generally electron gun will be used to produce the electron beam, and in electron gun tungsten filament will be used. And if we are talking about operating voltage of this electron gun, so for same it will be 1 to 30 kilovolt, and for TEM it will be 80 to 300 kilovolt. So this electron beam will be produced by tungsten filament which is present in the electron gun. So this is the complete details about principle and basics of SEM and TEM. I'm going to explain about scanning electron microscopy or SEM. So what is SEM? SEM is a type of electron microscope which produces image from the surface of the sample by using a electron beam. As you know, I have already explained the principle of this SEM and TEM in my previous video. Link of that video is given in the description as well as in the I button. So I will strongly recommend you to watch that video for better understanding the concept of SEM and TEM. Now coming to the various parts of scanning electron microscopy which is visible here. So first one is electron gun for production of electron beam. Second one is anode for acceleration of electron. Third one is condenser lenses. Fourth one is objective lens. Fifth one is motorized stage to hold the sample. And the last one is CPU and a monitor for recording the same image. Now coming to the first part of the instrument, that is electron gun. And this electron gun contains tungsten filament, and a high accelerating voltage, that is 1 to 30 kilovolt, is applied to produce the electron beam. So this electron gun will emit the electrons of various range, and typically 15 to 30 kilo electron volt electrons will be used for routine analysis in scanning electron microscopy. If we are talking about low voltage SEM, that is LVSEM, then lower electron voltage is used, that is 1 to 5 kilo electron volt. So in low voltage SEM we will get higher resolution of image. In this diagram you can see that electron gun is producing electron beam which is focused towards the sample, and it is represented in yellow lines. Now coming to the operating condition of SEM. So SEM instrument is operated at low vacuum, that is ranging from 0.1 to 10 to the power minus 4 Pascal. But if we are using volatile sample, in that case variable pressure same instrument is used, and the pressure may be up to 4 kilopascal. Now coming to the details about sample or specimen used in scanning electron microscopy. So any sample or specimen which will be used in SEM should be free from any type of contamination or dirt, otherwise it will strongly affect the quality of the imaging. If we are using any biological sample, then any sort of water should be removed from the sample by using the suitable method. So, to get the appropriate sample for SEM, samples are fixed in glutaraldehyde, dehydrated through a series of solvents, and dried completely either by using air or by using critical point method. This process will completely remove the water content present in the sample. After this process, sample will be taken and it will be mounted onto a special metal sample holder or stub. Then it will be coated and the coating will be ultra thin by using the gold or platinum or carbon. Thickness of this coating layer will be up to 10 nanometer. This coating is highly useful to get the proper imaging in SEM because samples may be beam sensitive or non-conductive. In both these cases, coating is highly essential. If we are talking about beam sensitive samples, then sputter coating or this ultra thin coating will help to prevent the damaging of the sample by electron beams. Because if samples are sensitive, then it will interact with electron and ultimately sample will be damaged. If we are talking about non-conductive materials as a sample, then whenever this electron beam will strike the sample surface, then electrons will be trapped by the sample and it will act as an electron trap. So in this case, sputter coating or ultra thin coating will help to spread the accumulated electrons in the surface. Now coming to the control of the electron beam, which is here produced by the electron gun. So this electron beam is controlled by anode, condenser lenses and objective lenses. And these lenses are electromagnetic lenses. If we are talking about anode, then anode is positively charged. And as you know, electron beam contains electrons which are negatively charged. So anode will attract the electrons and ultimately it will accelerate the velocity of electrons. Now it will go towards the condenser lenses. So condenser lenses will focus these electron beams towards the objective lens. Now coming to the objective lens. So objective lens will again focus these electron beams towards the sample. In scanning electron microscopy, raster scan generator is used for live scanning and it will help to complete scanning of the surface of specimen. Now coming to the detection in scanning electron microscopy. So in this process, three type of detection can be possible. First one is secondary electron detection, that is also known as SE detection. And as you know, secondary electrons are most abundant in the case of scanning electron microscopy. So this will be detected by using a suitable detector. Everhart Thornley detector or ET detector is most commonly used detector for detection of secondary electrons in SEM. And this ET detector contains biased grid which is positively charged to attract the secondary electrons, so they can be easily analyzed or they can be easily detected by this ET detector. And after detection of these secondary electrons by ET detector, it will produce the basic imaging of SEM. Because these secondary electrons are most abundant, so it will create basic imaging or fundamental shape of SEM. Now coming to the second type of electrons which are visible here, and those are backscattered electrons. So backscattered electrons are detected by BSE detector. In this BSE detector or backscattered electron detector, again ET detector is used, but that biased grid is having the varying voltage, means voltage will be variable, so it will repel the secondary electrons and it will attract the backscattered electrons, and the energy of backscattered electrons are higher as compared to secondary electrons. So it can differentiate between secondary electrons and backscattered electrons. Now coming to the third type of detection, that is X-ray detection. So as you know, in this process it will produce X-ray also that will be emitted in every direction. So inside that sample or specimen holder, X-ray detector will be inserted and it will detect the X-ray emitted by the sample by using X-ray detector. And this process is known as EDX or Energy Dispersive X-ray Analysis. So production of secondary electrons, backscattered electrons and X-rays are already discussed in my previous video. After the collecting the data from all these three detectors, central processing unit or CPU will process the data and it will give the final imaging or final scanning electron microscopy imaging in the monitor of the screen which is visible here. So this is the complete detail about scanning electron microscopy. Explain about transmission electron microscopy or TEM. And as you know, TEM is a technique of choice for analysis of internal microstructure, and it is also used for evaluation of nanostructures like fibers, particles or internal microstructure of cell. Now before watching this video, I will strongly recommend you to watch my previous video on principle of SEM and TEM for better understanding of this topic. Link of that video is given in the description as well as in the I button. So coming to the instrumentation of transmission electron microscopy, which will be visible here. And the first part is electron gun, which will produce electron beam. Second one is anode for acceleration of electron beam. Third one is condenser lenses. Fourth one is sample. Fifth one is objective lens. Sixth one is projector lenses. Seventh one is fluorescence screen. And if fluorescence screen will not be used, then nowadays CCD detector will be used. And this CCD detector is attached with a CPU and a screen. Now coming to the first part, that is electron gun. So just like scanning electron microscopy, in TEM also tungsten filament is used for production of electron beam. And in TEM, 80 to 300 kilovolt accelerating voltage is applied for production of electron beam, but in SEM it was 1 to 30 kilovolt. So here high voltage or high accelerating voltage is applied. That's why it will produce the high intensity of electron beam, which can penetrate the sample up to the thickness of 1 micrometer. Now coming to the operating condition of TEM. So just like SEM, TEM is also operated under vacuum, because in vacuum there will be no interference of air. Now let's discuss about the control of electron beam. So next part is anode, and the anode is positively charged. So this positively charged anode will attract the electron beam which is negatively charged, because electrons are present in the electron beam. So ultimately it will accelerate the speed of electron beam towards the condenser lenses. Now coming to the next part, that is condenser lenses. So here condenser lenses are actually electromagnetic lenses, and they will focus all those electron beam towards the specimen. So here if we will compare the condenser lenses of SEM and TEM, then as compared to same in TEM, number of these condenser lenses are much higher. So electron beam will be more accelerated and it can easily penetrate the specimen. So let's go to the next step of transmission electron microscopy, that is sample or specimen preparation. And this is the most difficult part of TEM analysis. And here very expertise or experience is required for preparation of sample, because very thin sample is required and it may be around 100 nanometer. So here sample holder will be around 3 mm in diameter and thickness of that sample holder may be up to 200 micrometer. As I have already told, sample or specimen preparation in TEM is a complex job and it needs expertise. So this sample preparation method in TEM is divided into 4 steps. First one is fixation, second one is rinsing, third one is secondary fixation, and the fourth one is dehydration. Now coming to the first step of sample preparation in TEM, that is fixation. So fixation can be done by 2 methods in TEM. First one is chemical fixation method and the second one is cryofixation method. If we are talking about chemical fixation method, then it can be done by treating the sample by using glutaraldehyde, that is a chemical. And if we are talking about cryofixation, then sample is freeze by using liquid nitrogen or liquid helium. Now in second step of sample preparation, rinsing will be done, and rinsing will be done by using a suitable buffer like sodium cacodylate. Now coming to the third step of sample preparation in TEM, that is secondary fixation. And this secondary fixation is for increasing the stability of internal structures, and it can be done by osmium tetroxide. Now coming to the fourth step of sample preparation in TEM, that is dehydration. And the dehydration of the sample can be done by using suitable solvent like ethanol or acetone. So finally, after preparation of sample will be kept in sample holder, and electron beam will strike the sample, and ultimately this electron beam will pass through the sample, and this transmitted electron beam will go towards the objective lens, and the objective lens is also an electromagnetic lens which will focus those electron beams or those transmitted beam towards the projector lenses. Now coming to the details about projector lens. So when this transmitted electron beam will go towards the projector lens, then projector lens will magnify these transmitted beams and it will focus these electron beams towards either fluorescence screen or towards CCD detector. So if fluorescence screen is used, then TEM image will be visible in fluorescence screen itself. And if CCD detector is used, then it will send the data towards the CPU, and ultimately CPU will process this data and it will be visible in the screen of computer. Now coming to the details about TEM imaging mode. So there are various TEM imaging modes are available to get the maximum information about the sample by using TEM image. And amongst all those, most common modes are bright field imaging, electron diffraction, high resolution TEM, that is also known as HR TEM, scanning TEM or STEM, and high angle annular dark field. Now coming to the details about first one, that is bright field imaging. If we are talking about electrons after passing the specimen, then there are two possibilities. Either these electrons will be scattered or this may be unscattered. If we are talking about scattered electrons, then there will be again two type of scattering. First one is elastically scattering and second one is inelastically scattering. So here elastically scattering means there will be no loss of energy, means wavelength will be same but angle will be slightly changed. And if we are talking about inelastically scattering, then there will be change in energy, means energy will be low as well as angle will be changed. Now coming to the second type of electrons, and those are unscattered electrons, and these unscattered electrons are used for bright field imaging. बिकॉज इन राइट फील्ड इमेजिंग स्केटर्ड इलेक्ट्रॉन्स विच आर इलास्टिक एंड इन इलास्टिक आर प्रिवेंटेड और ब्लॉक्ड बाई द ऑब्जेक्टिव लेंस, सो अल्टीमेटली वी विल गेट ओनली अनस्केटर्ड इलेक्ट्रॉन्स विच विल फॉर्म द टेम इमेज. सो इन ब्राइट फील्ड इमेजिंग एरियाज ऑफ द स्पेसिमेन दोज आर एक्टिवली स्केटरिंग आर हैविंग लेस नंबर ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉन्स, सो दोज फील्ड्स विल बी विजिबल डार्कर इन ब्राइट फील्ड इमेजिंग. नाउ कमिंग टू द सेकंड मोड, दैट इज इलेक्ट्रॉन डिफ्रेक्शन. सो एज आई हैव टोल्ड, इलास्टिकली डिफ्रेक्टेड इलेक्ट्रॉन्स विल नॉट लूज द एनर्जी एंड वेव लेंथ विल बी सेम. So these elastically diffracted electrons will be focused by the post specimen lenses and it will form a TEM image, and that is known as electron diffraction mode. So let's discuss about high resolution TEM. If specimen are ultra thin, that is 100 nanometer or less, then it will show elastic as well as inelastic scattering. And the electron waves are interacting with crystal lattice diffract. So it will form complex interference pattern. It will be visible at 4 lakh x or more. And ultimately it will give high resolution TEM image or HRTEM. Now coming to the fourth mode, that is scanning TEM or STEM. Some TEM instruments are fitted with scan coils which can scan a focused electron beam across the specimen. If we are talking about SEM, then this same process is done by raster scan generator. So it will focus across the specimen and it will completely scan the specimen area. Now coming to the fifth mode, that is high angle annular dark field or HAADF. In this mode, electrons which are incoherent and scattered through very high angle, those electrons are collected by using this technique and it will form a TEM image. So this is the complete details about transmission electron microscopy.